seeing the blue team ranger go down. He's running a fairly standard Beastmaster build with 30 points in Beastmastery, so that he's able to almost one-shot any of the squishy classes like the Mesmer or the Thief, which you can see the red team has both an Elementals and a Thief. So he can put some pretty good damage while being fairly safe himself, as only his pet has to go in. And we're seeing Jox. He's running a mostly Valor-based Guardian build, so he's just going to try and do a point defense. He's using the great, Greatsword, so he's going to try and put some damage. They're going on Slavenir. I do not know how to pronounce the name.
Spawnier.
Am I doing a decent job, Lynette?
You're doing okay. You're doing okay.
See there, the casting's not bad, but your analysis of the builds is really off, because Valor is typically a full DPS build, especially with support build that's roaming. He's not going to be good at point defense because he does not have the allies around him to benefit from each boon he puts on them healing him.
Another good thing to do is look at the runes, dude, because he's running two water and three divinity, which, that's a straight up damage build.
I didn't really get time to research the Guardian, so I agree.
Get out of here. Seriously, and another thing League of Legends note, is over, using, out.
He's using the Scepter shield, which allows him to actually stop people and get that burn down on him, and then jump to him on the Greatsword and get the burst down from the Greatsword.
I almost hit random team.
Good job.
I kind of want to jump in.
Hit spectate. No.
You press N. Not you hit spectate. No, you press N, because I'm a good boy.
I don't care what you press, what you hit. Get in the damn spectator position. Let's go ahead and go.
Okay, opening up the map here, we can look at the splits. It looks like the red team doesn't exactly know what they're doing. Blue team's looking like they're going to go for a hard push mid, which is typically what a lot of people go for in this meta, unless they're crossing far. Looks like they're both going to go defensively for their home knowns, but we'll see if there's any crossing going on. Looks like the Mesmer's the first to make it on point here in mid. Let's take a look at Bane, the Mesmer. He is running a great sword pistol. Go ahead.
If we take a look at core, we're going to see a 2v1 against a ranger. It's going to be a necro and a ranger versus another ranger. So blue team's going to come out a little ahead on that one. They're going to get that extra point down, and we're going to see a lot of fight going down in the grave. We're seeing in waterfall, we're seeing Dem Buns, a great name, doing the decap on the waterfall. So hopefully they try and get a little more points going. So you're going to see blue team get a lot of income coming in for points.
Fight here erupting mid. Looks like Bane is going to have to be pushed off. Looks like Red has invested heavily here in taking this point, and they're going to focus him down. But as a Mesmer, he's able to try to escape while reinforcements come in. Looks like his partner coming in here is Dembuns. He is running a staff sword focus, so a little more defensive. It looks like he is running a Phantasm build, which in the current meta is not generally taken just because the Shatter can bring so much damage to the team fight. Red team really securing the advantage here. They're just pushing out those blue players. A lot of this comes through the fact that they actually do have a more defensive Guardian that can sit on point and actually take the damage for them while they're able to throw out their DPS.
And on this Thief, we're actually seeing a really unique build. He's going straight down Shadow Arts and Trickery, doing 30 in both of those, and he's getting the 10 points in the Deadly Arts in Mug. He's not really going to have too much in terms of damage. And he's using a dagger pistol and a... he's using dagger and pistol. As you guys know, the pistol is obvious.
Sorry to interrupt you, but they're actually having an early Lord push by the blue team. Looks like there's one from red team here to support. If they get this secure on the red Lord right here with the 2-person advantage, they will be able to boost themselves 150 points, which would really be big because right now they are about 10 points behind with 0 capture points. So if they fail here, they're really sacrificing points later on in the game because they're going to have to respawn and take back all those points that the red has accumulated, putting them in a bad position. But let's see here if they get the Lord kill. Looks like red team is not doing a whole bunch to support, but blue team is not putting out a whole lot of damage. Looks like they're about to go down, and no, they are not going to get this Lord kill. Okay, over at Waterfall, looks like we have one Mesmer, Banban going for the decap. Smart decision, seeing as right now they're really going to have to get together and pull ahead here on points. Maybe a strong push for mid would be good, seeing as they really don't have any position or dominance in this map.
Someone has their Skype sound on. It's actually getting a little annoying.
Well, that's okay, because no offense, but your back and forth as casters is not doing so great right now, and I think that's mostly on the part of Mirox. Mirox, when you're casting with another caster, you have to be really careful about having a fluid back and forth. You can't leave long pauses in between in between points. Who's not in game?
Mirox.
Then who is...
I was joking about that. Oh, my God. Skype about that.
Get... Wow. I'm already about to seriously just kick you out. Spectate off of me, you retard.
I am spectating.
So you're in the game. You're watching. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, how else
then
would I have done
Araki,
this?
Make sure there's talking at all points.
Then Araki, hush and get out. League of Legends guys, out of call now. Okay. Now I'm going to say this again. All right. When you're casting with somebody, you have to have a fluid back and forth. So when somebody drops off on a point, you should already be thinking of something else to say.
Okay.
Don't worry about the camera work or anything like that. If you see something going on the map, probably your best bet to make sure that the viewers are actively seeing what you're talking about, since I'm running camera right now, is either to give a name, a class, or talk about where it's happening. Preferably the first one. Names are just easier for me to find and click on. But you have to have that fluid back and forth. When somebody drops off on a point, you immediately pick up and start talking. Also, hi, Sean.
How's it going?
Pretty good. How's it going with you?
Hey, not bad.
All right. Are you ready to actually hop in here and give me some help?
Yeah, I'm inspecting the same game you are.
All right, cool. And it looks like Justin's call has dropped. So, Sean, why don't you go ahead and jump right into it for us?
Are we doing an analysis, right?
Yeah. Well, this is just caster training in general, so I don't really care what we do, whether it's analysis or play-by-play and color. Just kind of do whatever at this point.
Okay. So who are we doing the training with today?
We've got Mirox in here, and we had the other guy...
Sean.
Yeah, whose name
Justin
I can't
Reed.
Remember. Yeah, Justin in here, because I totally know people's names, but it looks like his call disconnected, so right now it's just you and Mirox, Sean.
I think he went out when you said all the league people get out.
No, he was...
You fired him.
I think he was in here when I joined.
Yeah.
And then
he was.
Oh, it just dropped.
His call dropped.
I'm in here too, Lunette.
Oh, yeah, and Grizz.
No one cares.
Ouch.
No one cares.
I think he just got told.
All right, so is everyone now spectating this game?
Yes, we're all spectating this game, so we can go ahead and get back into it.
All right, guys. Cool.
Hold on, is Minox play-by-play or color?
He's Me? Probably going to end up being play-by-play, considering he hasn't played the game for very long.
That is slightly true, yes.
Oh, one thing I do need to tell you guys is, like, if you were planning on casting this game, you guys need to start playing, dude. Like,
yeah.
No, like,
it's the biggest complaint. I'm not directing it towards you. I'm directing it towards literally half of, almost every streamer for this game, or caster for this game, even Blue. They don't play the game. And, like, there's so many complaints I'm reading on the forums and stuff. Like, I think me and Grouch are the only two people that, like, play this game daily.
Yep.
And so,
Okay, it looks like...
Daily, you guys are just asleep.
It looks like Justin's coming back. He's actually a pretty decent necromancer, so, like,
he's really good.
Yeah, most of the guys we've ended up hiring on know what they're doing in the game. I think the only exceptions to that being myself and Mirox, who wanted to come in for some ungodly reason.
I actually think only, Justin... is the only good person.
Ouch.
not like caster, but I mean like good
player wise. Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Hey, what about that one day when I pooped on you?
Shut up, Grizz. Let's go ahead. Let's
this
go ahead.
This game's almost over, so.
Yeah, I know, but you guys suck. You guys.
So
suck.
One of the things we do at the beginning of every game, usually in a tournament setting, is there's a couple minutes that we took before the game to go over everyone's equipment.
Over the item builds and trait builds and everything?
Yeah, exactly. Items and traits as well as skills. In hot joins, we don't get that opportunity because as soon as it switches, it automatically starts off. But when the next game starts, Grizz, have you ever done color casting for this game before?
Heck no, man. I can do play-by-play.
So you guys are both just play-by-play. Okay, I'll do color casting next time. And then me and you will do the item builds. We'll go over the item builds, Grizz.
Okay.
So you can get an example of what's going on with that. So again, we usually start red team, go from top to bottom, and switch over to blue.
Oh, that'll Kylo. All right, first off, for the red team on Arathil, we are going to, looks like, have all five, 7 of 6, okay. Ruins of the Nightmare and PvP Rabid Amulet. The traits are going to be a 0, 20, 20, 0, 30. Is that a typical build that we see on Mesmers?
Not at all. This is actually a Shatter Condition build for a Mesmer. Not something you typically see, but we'll see how he makes it work today.
All right, moving on over to Jox, who is a Guardian. He's going to be running quite a bit of different runes. He's going to be having 2 runes of the Monk, 2 runes of the Water, and 3 runes of the Divinity. Along with that, going to have the Shaman's Amulet, and traits are going to be 30-0-0-25-10. Or actually, I'm sorry, 25-15. That doesn't look like a quite typical Guardian build to me.
That's not. That's actually, again, another hybrid build. He's going for the condition damage as well as the healing survivability. Not something you see too often on Guardians. Heading over to Lueth on Thief, he's actually running the Marks of the Water. And he's going Dagger, Dagger, Pistol, Pistol with the Soldier's Amulet. Traits, he's running 10-0-30-0-30. Not too typical for a thief. Really going for a more sustained damage and survivability than that burst.
All right, switching over here to the blue team, we have Bane Bane, who's going to have 7 runes of divinity along with the soldier's amulet. Traits are going to be 0-0-15-15. And 30. What do you think about that build?
It's definitely a staff-centered shatter build. Not something we see too often. Maybe a little more survivability, especially with the soldier's amulet there. Pretty much going to go into team fights and just stay alive.
All right, and then moving on to Neelis Paris, the Necromancer over here, going to be actually having Ruins of the Earth with the Knight's Amulet, and the traits are going to be a 20-0-30-20-0 build. God damn it.
So this is actually a power necro build. He's going the double dagger as well as the axe warhorn. He's trying to get into fights with the minions. The minions are going to be doing massive damage. He's going to be doing massive damage, but he's not really going to have that survivability. He's going to have that giant health pool, so when he goes into Death Shroud, he's going to survive a little longer. But he has no innate escape in this build. So you're going to see him. He's really going to need support from his team to make this work.
All right. And then moving on to Astralon. Going to be a Ranger here. It looks like he's going to be running with a couple different sets of runes. 5 of the Eagle and 2 of the Ranger with a Berserker's Amulet. And the traits are going to be a 20-20-0-0-30. That looks like a typical Beastmaster build, don't you think?
It's more of a damage Beastmaster build. He has no points into nature's magic for like the healing you see on a lot of like node defenders. He's also running the Berserker amulet instead of a normal Shaman's amulet. So definitely going for almost a hybrid build with the burst and the conditions instead of the conditions and survivability.
And looking at his utility skills, almost every single one of them is geared towards making his pet deal more damage. He has Sic'em, he has the Signet of the Hunt, Signet of the Wild, which all make your pet stronger. And for his elite, he's running Rampage 1, which also buffs your pet. So,
yeah, just that insane burst damage is going to be coming out of him. He's actually stomping everyone right now.
Getting them stomps off. All right, moving on to Okran. Going to be Necromancer with Mask of the, or actually Ruins of the Warrior with the Night Amulet. And the traits are going to be 15-0-0-30-0. And it looks like he's missing points.
Yeah, he's missing a lot of points, actually. He was also setting up to run that that power build that's a little uncommon on Necros. He's running with Signets and Lich. It does massive damage, but it really does need a team to help support it to peel for him since he has no escape. So we do have everyone's item set there. Blue team is actually destroying this game. They have a really strong 3-cap. Red is having a little trouble with their trebuchet. Constant pressure is keeping them really busy and knocked off that.
And we're going to see Banebane trying to go for the enemy's windmill, but he's getting pushed off of the point. Meanwhile, Jurna, the red team guardian, looks like, is trying to put some pressure on the enemy's trebuchet, trying to just zone people off, but he's getting 2v1'd, and he just gets taken down really quickly. Meanwhile, we're seeing the sheer damage output that the Ranger's able to put down. He's trying to focus the enemy's Necro, but he's just taken down by the Warrior, who looks like he's running a gun build, which is not very common at all.
Okay, so just to go... we'll both do something real quick. Okay. I just wanted to talk about the build section.
No worries, go for it.
When talking about the build, one thing we need to start doing is when we go over runes, if it's a full set, instead of just saying like 6 out of 7 or 6 out of 6, just say they have a set of divinity, and then only go into it if they split. I think that makes it a lot easier, and it really changes things up. It sounds better, too. That's just the big thing I wanted to say. Go ahead, Lynette.
Yeah, as far as play-by-play goes, Mirox, you kind of have to make a choice now so whether or not you want to invest in learning about the play-by-play or invest in learning about the color. The reason I say it is because it's two very distinct styles of casting.
Well, I already knew that.
And you are coming in here as kind of a new caster, and when you go into the play-by-play, it has to be very fluid, even if you don't necessarily know what you're talking about. And you have to have that excitement. You're kind of very deadpan right now on everything that's going on, and you have to have a little bit more excitement into the voice, especially when things start to hit like their peak and the climax of the fight. You know, when somebody's going in for a stomp there, you got to get really excited and sound like, you know, you're really into it. That kind of thing goes for all games. So try and do that a little bit more with your play-by-play, and try not to pause. Play-by-play needs to be very fluid, more so than color casting.
Yeah, which Super is kind of why I was saying that I was that. Going...
Go ahead, Mirox.
Which is why I was kind of saying that I was probably going to be going for color, but you guys were saying that I'm supposed to be doing play-by-play for this broadcast.
Just, you can go for color. I just don't think you have the knowledge of the game to execute it properly, but you can do it. Like, that's not a problem. I'm just giving you, like, a little bit of advice.
Yeah, if you want to start casting now, color is going to take you a long time to get into. Like, I played this game for, like, 1,000 hours at the launch, and back to it, I play, like, 6 hours a day. For the last 2 months, and I still feel like I don't know anything about this game.
Yeah.
So the color is pretty intense for this game.
In order to understand every single build on every single class, you have to play multiple hours a day every single class to fully understand them, which is ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So color does take a lot longer to get into right now. And then For play-by-play, if you do some of that, or even in color, if you're not sure, like, abilities or classes, just go with quick descriptions off the top of your head. I mean, when you see something, you don't necessarily have to pause and look at the skills, because you want to be really fluid. You know, if a warrior just used, like, kill shot or something, you know, you just say you shot him. You don't have to go in, oh, what's an enhanced skill? I mean, you know, the warrior just shot a huge, you know, the warrior just shot his rifle and dealt a huge damage. You don't have to say the warrior charged up his rifle for 3 seconds and landed a kill shot.
Yeah.
Because that's a lot of people I talk to, like when they're starting Guild Wars, they actually try and do that. They'll like pause for a second and like look at skills. It seemed like you were pausing for a second there trying to look at classes and stuff right there. If you can't get it off the top of your head, you don't need to. You don't need to like name the classes. Yeah. Just kind of show off what they're doing.
Okay. That makes sense.
That actually helps a lot. So now that this game's almost over, if you and Grizz actually can try doing the items, we want to be quick about the items too. If you don't know a lot, that's not fine. Just make something up for now.
Yeah.
When it comes to like discussing about it, okay. And then just go quick. Try and do it in under like a minute and a half for all 10. And then just go straight into casting. If you guys even want to just switch off doing like play-by-play stuff so you can both practice.
Okay.
That might be good for you guys as well.
Yeah, I was a bit distracted earlier with a million effing phone calls.
If that sounds good to you,
Lynette. I'd like to see the both of them concentrate a little bit on color casting just to see how they do. I'm actually going to mute myself and do essentially some mute play-by-play so you guys can focus on the color and I can start doing casting practice of my own. So Grizz is going to do red side and Mirox is going to do blue side in terms of discussing item builds. And we'll go ahead and get into this next one here in just a second. And for the people who are asking on stream, we'll go ahead and get you the server name. It's 103. So you are, you're free to, I guess, come in on the next match and have your game spectated if you really want. If you really want.
It's Anvil Rock.
Yeah, it is Anvil Rock. That, I guess, would have been some important information I should have disclosed at an earlier date. But whatever.
It doesn't really matter. You just need to know the server.
Ew,
you can do it from any home
I hate
server.
Raid of Capricorn.
So awesome. This is where
this one.
No, you're Bueller, wrong. Grizz, you're wrong.
I killed Bueller.
No, I hate this one.
All right, and starting with the red team, actually, I lied. He left, so I don't have anyone to cast. There we go. Astralon, going to be a ranger. He's actually going to have a couple different sets of runes here. 5 of the eagle and 2 of the ranger with a berserker zamlin. We're gonna go over to the traits here, and he has a 20-20-0-0-30 beastmaster, and it looks like not quite done setting up with that, obviously, because he doesn't have all of his signets out, and I really don't know much about ranger.
Whereas on the other team you see bane, he's playing mesmer. He's going down mostly divinity runes, and he has a great sword and a sword and pistol. It's a good dueling to build with lots of damage. He's as for traits, he has 10, 30, 0, 25, 5. And as I said, it's really good at doing solo battles. It has good condition removal. It does just generally good damage. Uses the phantoms well. And we have Nilan Paris on the Necro. He's running a minion master build using using a complete set of earth. He's has double daggers and a dagger and a focus. He's using for traits, it's 20-0-30-20-0, which is, as I said, it's a mostly minion master build. So he gets those minions and he's just going to try and deal damage through them and try and survive a little bit. For this thief, he's using all Lisa runes. This is pretty common for a defensive thief. He has a sword and then dagger and pistol. So he's going to be trying to stay in melee combat mostly, just rolling around evading. And for traits, he has 10-0-30-30-0. So he's getting that extra acrobatics, getting that extra shadow arts for the innate tankiness. He's going to be, whenever he uses ability, he's going to heal himself. And he's just going to have a ton of initiative. So he's going to be darting in and out of the fights. And he's just going to try and stay in there.
And over here on Will Raptor on the red hand side, he's going to be he's a thief having 6 runes of the Divinity, along with the Zerka's Amulet, with the short bow of fire and pistol, actually sword of air now. And his traits are going to be a 30-30-0-0-10. Obviously, he's going for a real high damage build with really low survivability because he doesn't have any of his stealth abilities. On his bar, moving over to Okron here, Necromancer, he's going to have 6 runes of the water with a Knight's Amulet. And he's going to be running a dagger staff build. And with that, his runes are going to be 15-0-0-30-0. Missing, obviously, I don't think he has his build fully finished here. And with that, we'll go ahead and jump right into the action.
Seems like Lunette might still be a little muted.
She's going to stay that way. So it's gonna
Okay. So we had a new person hop onto the blue team, just joined middle of the fight. I'm guessing it's probably one of the people watching the stream. It's a ranger using a mostly solo build without using the pet, not caring too much about the pet damage, which is a little outside of the meta. For runes, he's using all ranger, and he's using a greatsword and longbow, both sigiled with a force. Using force for the sigil, this is kind of uncommon. Normally, you see rangers go down beast mastery, so they get that, and that they don't, and they try and stay as defensive as possible through wilderness survival and nature magic, and they try and just be tanky and just let their pet do the damage. But looks like he's going to try and do the damage himself.
And unfortunately, right now at 11 minutes into the game, blue team has a tremendous lead, actually having capped all 3 positions. Including runes, which will make it hard for red team to recap. And it looks like Astralon here in a lot of trouble, getting dove in by Jirla Link. And it looks like she will get it. Yeah, she does get the smash off on the Astralon, leaving her down and dead. And Okron over here on Doc, actually in a lot of trouble, taking a lot of damage from, it looks like, Neelan Paris, a Necro, doing a fantastic job just dealing out tons of damage. And unfortunately, Okron does go down, but Neelan Paris cannot get the smash off because he does have a friend there, Willow Raptor. But now all 3 members of the blue team are here. Oh, now the 4th member of the blue team is here over here at Doc. Unfortunately, both members from the red team are down. One getting smashed and the other getting smashed now. And yes, Willow Raptor will go down, leaving blue team still with all 3 points.
Meanwhile, it looks like Astron's going to be trying to go for ruins, try and decap that, try and secure themselves at least some points over time. And the teams are pretty imbalanced right now. It's a 2-4. So we're going to see one player switch over sides, maybe make the game a little more balanced. But we're seeing the blue team try and get down to ruins, make it so it's not a completely uncontested point. We're seeing the sharks come down and absolutely tear the Mesmer apart. Just tear Bane just to shreds.
But, and it looks like red team is going to come over here and try and contest Doc. Neelan Paris doing a great job pulling out all of his pets, and the thief is looking at his stealth and going to try and come in and attempt to burst on Neelan Paris. And yes, the fight is on, but minions are out, taking a lot of damage. Astralon in a lot of trouble, but it looks like Neelan Paris is going to continue to defend Doc, just kiting around. God, this camera sucks. And another member from red team is now joined into the fray. Doc looks like going to be contested by red team here. Neelan Paris doing everything he can to try and survive, but he is really low health and he is now feared and in a lot of trouble. And it looks like he will go down. Yes, he is now in the down. And let's see. Yes, we are going to see a smash coming in. And there it is, go down on Astralon. Meanwhile, Astralon was taken down along with Neelan Paris, leaving Doc uncontested. It looks like blue team's going to have an easy time capping this. And there's another man down, and the smash does go down on the Willow Raptor, leaving 2 members down, or was 2 members down, Willow Raptor going down, and it looks like it will be going back to a triple cap for the blue team with 8 minutes left in the game at 4:37.
They're only 60 points away from winning. I don't think there's much that red team can possibly do to come back into this game, despite it being a 4v4 now. One thing that I want to point out that Neelan Paris was doing during that fight is he was staying inside the point so that the red team was not getting the free cap. He stayed there as long as he could to make it so that it was not going down, so that they kept getting points. That's generally, you want to try and fight on the point just because of that reason itself. And he's going to be summoning up some minions, trying to hold down the last 2 points, make sure that red team cannot decap them and do a fantastic turnaround. So it's
And red team now over here at Ruins, all three members, looks like they will wind up getting this cap, and they do, leaving Wolvera and Ilana's Silver Spell to attempt to contest this. Silver Spell taking a lot of damage along with Willowraptor. All four members, or three members from the blue team, are there, causing red team actually a lot of havoc as members from the red team do go down. Raptor trying to swim up to revive himself, leaving red open, or I'm sorry, leaving Ruins open for recapture. And with that, it doesn't matter because blue team ends it with 565 with 7 minutes and 40 seconds left in the game.
That is over a 400 point difference. That's how substantial the difference was in this game.
Welcome to a 4v2. Like, anybody expected any differently to happen in that game? I'm just throwing it out there.
Yeah. No, definitely a stomp, but that's what happens in hot joins. Like, all these builds are pretty terrible. But people are just trying stuff out. Okay.
And like I said, it was going to happen at one point. I accidentally hit random teams, so I'm hopping back into spectate right now. I knew it was going to happen eventually.
You definitely were a lot more excited through a lot of the parts, which is pretty good. Grizz, you're actually a lot more clear that game, which is fantastic. Like, you didn't get stumbled on too many words, which is really
on the names of retarded names.
Yeah, you know, when something like that, because there was that one time you did get caught on the name.
On the guardian name?
Just
the name of the class.
Yeah, he's getting bursted. He's going down. You don't need to say the name. You know, if the camera's on it and you're watching it and people can see it, there's no reason to throw the name if it's gonna slow you down.
Yeah, I know. I gotta break my professionistness.
Yeah,
because it's like I gotta get that name down.
It's just something you gotta build on. Like, you start out with something, and then, you know, after doing it, you know, then you can bring that into. But we just want to make sure it's, like, all nice and fluid.
Yeah. We've gone a bit into the builds. I think we've done that about twice now. So let's just go straight into casting this one. You know, there's no reason to go in anything, obviously. Like we've said before, Hot Join is going to be a bit different from the tournaments and probably the scrims, too. So we just kind of want to hop right into this one and get you guys into it. I'd like to just hear the color casting this time. Grizz, that was some decent play-by-play by you last time. I was a lot happier with that time than the last time I saw you cast last week.
Oh, God. I suck at color. You know this, woman.
Well, it's... Yeah, you just explain it the way... I mean... This game is 500 points. Like, one team has to get 500 points. There's a million things you can talk about on how a team's going to get to 500 points.
It's not just a triple cap. You do have the orb that automatically neutralizes the point and gives them 15 points as well.
We're seeing a double Mesmer build on the blue team. I don't really think that this is too powerful setup, but it seems like they're pretty good friends. They both have the exact same name. One of them just has an extra L. Your goal is to try and get that orb and bring it to one of the points. It'll get you a big major boost. Otherwise, you can just try and defend it, get a bunch of kills, slowly raise your points with that, or just get the triple cap, which red team has. It'll slowly build 3 points every 2 seconds. And they're just going to try and hold that as long as possible.
Yeah, and with that, but the one crucial thing about either defending orb or trying to run it in, it gives you, I believe, what is it, 30 points if you already have that point, Sean?
It gives you 30 points if you already have it, and you have 15.
Okay, 15, and not only 15, but it auto-neutralizes that point to make it easier for you to cap.
Yep.
So having key control of the orb is quite critical on this map. Just due to some fact of A, it can give you 30 points, or B, it can neutralize and give you 15 points as well. And it does look like both teams are trying to defend it. Over on the red team, Nylon Paris, the Necromancer, doing as much damage as he can. We do see he has all of his pets out and is going down on that smash. But it really doesn't look like he's running too much of the obvious pet necro build. Looking over his ruins here, and he's also using double daggers as well. Bane. Go ahead.
seems like he's trying to do a little bit of both, doing a little bit of condition, but he's bringing Spectral Grasp to pull the enemies into where all of his minions are. He's been using that pretty nicely. Then he goes into Death Shroud, drops his life transfer, just tries to nuke them down as quickly as possible. He's working really well with his team. As soon as he does that, Jura the Thief was switching on the same target. They're working pretty good as a team.
Yeah, and as we see over at Bear, there is going to be an orb that is about to be capped for the red team. Blue team in a really bad situation here. Not really. They spent most of their time trying to defend that orb and not go for point to try and cap it. And we do see Waria now heading over there to try and cap it. But at this point in time, 10 minutes left in the game. It's almost 435 and they're triple capped. Blue team has to get that triple cap and start running orbs in order to turn this around, and I just don't see that happening.
The one thing that I want to outlet is Bane was defending the Bear Shrine against the Ranger, and as I was saying earlier, it's a very offensive build. It has a ton of burst. He was able to take down the Ranger in about 8 seconds. It was an absolute slaughter fest on the point. He just didn't see it coming. And we're...
Same thing with actually Jera Leek over here having a look at that build again, having... 6 ruins or 7 ruins of the Lissa going for a condition damage build. Looks like high DPS, having a look at the abilities that she has. She has Infiltrator Signet, Shadow of the Refuge for survivability, and Withdraw as it... I'll actually go ahead and read that. Withdraw, roll backward while healing and evade attacks, cures immobilized, chilled, and crippled. So that is a really strong kind of survive slash damage, getting the condition duration with the Ruins Alyssa.
Yeah, and looking at the build, it's pretty similar to what Jumper used in the Curse Tournament over the weekend. It has enough defensive capabilities through its dodges, and it has lots of dodges. When you switch your weapon sets, it gives you more endurance. It keeps a lot of initiative, so you're able to teleport in and out. He was able... at least when Jumper was doing it, he's able to do a 4-on-1 at a center point in one of the maps.
Okie dokie. All getting right, into that was next
that
game.
Was pretty decent for a stomp. I think there are, and this is again from an outside perspective, bearing in mind that my knowledge of the game is fairly limited at the moment. Apparently nobody's in this game. All right. It's 0-0. Awesome. Good time to talk about this. Anyways. I feel like there are some important points that you guys had to kind of be quicker on the draw talking about. It took you guys a very long time to note that they were 3 capped and that they had, and that the red team had control of all of the points. I felt like this was kind of something that needed to be talked about right off the bat. You know, we got into the game, we discussed that we weren't going to be doing essentially going over the build, and then immediately after that, everybody got 3 capped. You know, you could see that coming into the match from the way that everybody was heading. They went ahead and took control of all of the points, and then it was just a flat-out fight over the orb. It took you guys a very long time to mention that, and it's something that was very crucial that played a huge point in the game that should have been discussed and evaluated immediately.
Yeah. I was accidentally signed in as a player to the game originally, so that was kind of my fault.
No worries.
As I knew it would happen eventually, just my natural reaction to hit random team.
No worries. It doesn't look like we're going to have a game here, so how about we go ahead and get out of this one, and let's go ahead and I'm going to join another server real quick, so you guys might want to get out of that one. So we're going to go through one more game with Mirox and Grizz, and then I think Sean and I are going to do a game or two. Mostly because play-by-play will be easier for me to practice with a dedicated color caster that isn't Grizz Cop.
I told you I suck at color casting, Lunette.
Dude, I'm messing with you. Calm down.
I'm gonna cry. I'm very sensitive.
Oh, you poor baby.
My nipples hurt.
Oh my god. And there we go. Apparently that's a legitimate thing. When you run marathons, your nipples chafe. I did not know that.
And they can even start to bleed if it's a really long one or if you have a bad fabric.
Apparently you have to, like, tape them down and stuff. I did not know about any of this.
You put the tape on it so that it's not directly going to your nipple, so it's going on the tape. So
that sounds really
so you don't
weird
get that
still.
Rubbage.
Yeah.
Or if you're like me and you snowboard shirtless and wipe out, it's a lot of fun. Bleeding nipples are OP.
Or you can just go without any clothes. That's I hear that's a good thing to do in a marathon.
I did that until I got arrested.
I was going to say, you'd go 23 miles to the police station pretty quickly.
And this is the point where you guys spectate off of me, you jerks.
I am joining right now.
All right.
Thank
so
you
let's,
for informing us.
Yeah, we're going to... And we're pretty much bullshitting till this game is over, but for this next one... Let me make sure I'm not unmuted. Okay. So for this next one, I want Grizz to do play-by-play. Roxy is going to do color casting. Roxy, obviously, you're going to have to put a lot of work into learning how to do color casting for the game, since it's kind of what you want to invest into. So I really want you to work on that. Watching Jumper's stream is probably one of the better things that you could actually do to teach yourself.
I've just been sitting in Skype, and he's been teaching me the game in general, but...
Yeah, that
works too. I've been going class by class, talking to most, like, the better players of each class, like, talking to Jumper. I also talked to Cade a little bit.
Yeah, Cade.
Talking to, I think...
Shut up, Sean!
Sorry. Yeah, I was laughing at you.
Yeah, of course
I was laughing with you.
Oh my god. I remember my first real game of PvP. Cade camped me so hard, I cried all day. QQ, QQ. Nah, seriously, Cade and Jumper are pretty cool, though, and they are really good people to talk to if you want to learn the classes, so that's good.
Yeah, I'm just going class by class trying to learn them all, at least the competitive builds. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily just, like, random skill alignments, but only ones that are really used.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's important to bear in mind that, your color casting, it's not, you don't have to worry about the execution, you don't have to worry about doing any of that as long as you can essentially memorize the mechanics itself and rattle it off like a giant fact sheet, you're pretty much good to go. Oh no, and I am pretty sure Skype just disconnected me. And the call went down. I'm gonna join the call again and see if that fixed it. Hello? Hello? Oh, that's not good. You guys on stream can apparently still hear me, but I can't. I'm apparently not in the Skype call anymore, ladies and gentlemen, and I have no idea what's going on. And apparently none of these people in the Skype call can hear me. So... That's not a good thing right now. Connection. Yes, I understand that there's a problem with the call. Thank you very much. So that kind of sucked. I'm going to turn on a little bit of music while I try and figure out a way to get back into the call. Ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy. I have no idea what else to say right now because I don't know what this... I don't know how to cast this game. This would be very bad if I tried by myself. So hang on a second. Let me go ahead and... There we go. No, casters didn't go on break. We had a bug with the Skype call. I'm getting back in with them now, so give me just a moment.
Oh, it's offline.
Oh, there we go. There we go. Hi.
Now it's online.
Hi, Lynette. Welcome back.
Thanks.
We were not talking anything.
Yeah.
We were sitting here quietly.
Yeah, we didn't say anything about you.
You know what? You know what? I'm gonna say this.
With our hands?
I mean this in the nicest way I possibly can, okay? As somebody who loves all of you very, very, very dearly. Go shove a rolling pin up your ass.
Too late.
No, we didn't go on a break. We were just waiting for the next game to start while there was some Skype problems. We are going to be starting up right here. Grizz on play-by-play and Roxy on color casting.
Okay, looking at
are we going to skip over builds or just go straight into the game?
No builds.
Okie dokie. And going straight into the game here, it is going to be Spirit Watch, and we have two members from the blue team. If you open up your map here, it looks like they're going to go ahead and head to Bear, leaving Raven and Wolf open. No member from red team has yet gone to Wolf, leaving, the Necro does turn to Wolf, leaving Raven uncontested by both blue and red team. As we see two members converging from red team onto Wolf and one member from blue team onto Bear. And looks like the Necromancer is going to go ahead and hurry over to that orb and pick it up to maybe quick cap Raven, or not Raven, but get some quick points down onto Bear to turn their lead over to the blue team. But red team now capturing their point at Wolf, going to head over to Raven. Might give them an early lead, with even though blue team has that orb.
And we're seeing a thief come onto the Necro with the orb, so maybe the Mesmer's going to come back, try and help him out a little bit.
Hopefully, and actually, Tyler the in a lot of trouble here. It is a thief on him, so hopefully he will take enough damage and drop, leaving that orb uncontested, and red team kind of getting into lead since the Mesmer's only just getting to Raven, but no, red team does wind up getting a Raven, giving red team the cap advantage right now, leaving orb open. And yes, the orb, it does look like the orb is dropped and uncontested right now.
Red team has picked up the double cap, and seeing as they actually have a guardian on their team, whereas it is an offense, a fairly offensive guardian, it is going to be a little better for defending it. We're seeing
Empress actually in a lot of trouble right now. Getting pulled back by the Guardian, taking quite a bit of damage right now, but not yet going down. There's a Necro, and yes, she's in actually a lot of trouble. She does wind up getting away, but no, she does wind up going down, and let's see if the Guardian will be able to get the smash, and no, she tries to blink away. She is in stealth right now, but in a lot of trouble from two members of the red team, and looks like the smash from Delbach will go down, and there it is, Empress getting smashed in the face, leaving this game is actually quite uneven. And there it is. Now it's back to even. It's no longer 4v2. It is a 3v3. Red team going for a triple cap here over at Bear. Blue team heading over to Raven to try and get that back cap, but leaving two members from red team over at Bear to take that.
And we're going to see... Oh, blue team's probably going to try and make a play for the orb so it auto-decaps one of the point so that they can hopefully try and quickly cap it, at least change it for from a 3 cap to a 2 versus 1. We're seeing Varish, a Mesmer try and cap that Raven, try and help his team a little bit. Tineshi's sitting right by Orb. He's going to try and burst down Orb Light, it looks like.
It looks like actually we just have a standoff between the two Thieves over here at the Orb. Orb Light actually taking more damage than he is dealing. Having to pop in the cell, looks like he's trying to get those cataprops. I don't even know how to say that down, but no, there he goes. Adastel dealing quite a bit of damage to him, and he has to blink away over that waterfall to get away from Tanishi.
Meanwhile, we're seeing Varish take a lot of damage from the enemy Necro. He's being pulled back in. Question, if it's something kind of like that where it's a fight that's kind of happening, should I just kind of take over?
Take over. If I'm looking at one fight and there's another fight going on, go ahead and jump right into that and I'll pick up after.
Okay. I just didn't know. Okay. Okay, cool. I just thought I'd ask. And we're seeing Orblet try and sit behind the enemy. They're trying to burst it down.
Fortunately, Lithocrates is there now. A bunch of damage. She is rocking the two-sword Guardian, so she will be able to deal a lot of damage. And it looks like they are going to go for that orb grab. And yes, they do get it. Lithocrates has it, but no, there's that Necro there that pulled him back. And it looks like red team could be in a bit of trouble. Orblight taking a lot of damage from two members of the blue team right now. Lethalcrace does continue to run up to get those 30 points, but no, gets knocked back by one of the Mesmers from Red Team. But Orbite still in a lot of trouble. Debok and Lethalcrace also taking a lot of damage. Ashara Android and Tishy Boshi both still at quite a bit of health, but Orblight's still in a lot of trouble just trying to run away from the fight. But no, he does eventually go down. Debok and Lethalcrace both low and in a lot of trouble. And the smash looks like going down onto Orblight, but no, Vishra Android gets taken down as one. It looks like we might see a smash down on Orblight, and no, it's not. And looks like we do see a member from the red team trying to pick him up. Vishra Android in a lot of trouble. Debok doing everything he can to save Orblight, but there is, and yes, a smash from Tinashe does go down, but no, Orblight flashes over, and actually Vishra Android gets a rally off and gets up with Orblight's death, leaving Debok into a lot of trouble. That Necro doing everything he can to stay alive right now, but in a lot of trouble as two members of Vishra Android and Tinashe continue down on the Debok, dealing a lot of damage, and the does eventually do go down, but will Tinashe get the, yes, Tinashe does get the smash on the Debok, leaving it 2v1 for the red team right now.
We saw during, like, while the fight was going on, the purple red team guardian was picked up the orb. He brought it up to the bear, so he got that extra 30 points. They have the triple cap. Blue team needs to try and get all three of these points at least decapped so they have a chance of coming back in.
Lethalcrace right now in a lot of trouble. 3v1 against a blue team, really low health. And yes, she does go down, but will Virish Android be able to get smashed? And yes, he does. There goes down the smash on the Lethalcrace, leaving it now still at 2v1 against the red team. Debok in a lot of trouble. Debok taking tons of damage from Android, but will it be enough? Will he get the smash down on the Debok? And the red team wins, and the smash does go down on Debok with 8 minutes left. 505-65, red team takes it.
One thing.
Oh, wait. Did it finish?
Yes.
Why is the game still going? I thought red team wins.
It still goes a little bit after so that people can finish their fights.
Yep. No, that was pretty good. Grizz, there's... How do I say this? There's a fine line between too much excitement and not enough excitement, and you have to be careful of your volume levels still.
I was yelled at to get extra loud towards the end of the game.
I know what Foxy told you, but Foxy is not me, so...
Well, okay.
And then next week when he's casting with Foxy.
And then Azeraki, and oh my god. My voice is going to be like, it's going to go up and down the entire game matches. It's going to be ridiculous. But right, I got what you mean.
If you guys actually want to go ahead and join the game so me and Lunette can cast, because there's not enough people.
But.
Pressure. Oh, no, I want to join.
One second, I'm going to switch classes then, okay?
Yep, go ahead. Starting off in this game, you do see blue team taking on the altar while red team is alone at the gate. Blue team's actually pushing both side points right now, which will give them an early lead advantage. Is Lunette there?
Lunette. Oh, no, not again. This will get me time to get into the game. Yes.
And that's naked time. We can't hear you at all.
So my mic was muted. I'm like having beautiful transitions into this fucking game, and my mic is muted, and I hate everything right now. Now.
Not a problem. Blue team does have 1 point and are up 42-15, 2 points now. Red team is able to take back Temple.
Yeah, and it looks like we had Grizz come up here and cap this. The moment he got in the game, he immediately started heading up here, and it looks like he's going to do his best to keep this point right now. Going to go ahead and get a little bit of health back, and it looks like he is coming in now potentially for a face-off, as it looks like we have this little thief here who is going to go ahead and get caught out. Grizz doing some best to try and evade some of this damage, but he is going to take quite a bit here. As it's now a 2v1, those blocks coming out, but still quite a bit of damage as Grizzrage is going to get very low. He's going to get that heal off, get up quite a bit of health, but no, here we go. Some of the AoE damage coming out. Looks like Yoda's coming in as well, but Grizz once again dropping low. He's got those buffs on him, but it may not be enough as he ends up getting knocked back, and he is down for the count. The question is, will they be able to DPS him down? Will he bleed out, or will they get the stomp off? But it looks like they're just going to ignore him. He is going to get the rally and get back up now. He's going to come back in, trying to do some damage, and it looks like the enemy guardian over here is going to go down. He's going to get very low, and it looks like they're just trying to DPS him down right now, but unfortunately, Grizz has got a lot of other stuff to handle, and it looks like the rally will go off. Grizz getting down very low again. Yoda as well getting down very low. Yoda will end up following Grizz and his ally. I have no idea. That is a ranger. I am so good at this game. This just goes to show how much I play. Both going to go down, and here we go. Will the stomp go off? Yes, it will, and it looks like he will end up following. Grizz getting down very low as well. Unfortunately, he is in a 2v1 situation right now, and he's going to do his best to get away, but it may not be enough. He's going to go ahead and get over in this little corner here, go for another roll and evade, but it is not likely going to be enough. He is going down, and yes, there we go. He finally goes down, and Grizz slowly starting to bleed out here as the rest of the team continues on with this fight. Sean, how is this going Absolutely. So far?
All the red team is just sitting there at the temple. They're trying to defend, and they were doing a fantastic job with all their boons and their survivability, but blue team finally manages to take it. The problem we're seeing right here is red team is not going to altar and gate, which have been largely uncontested. If red team would split their forces a little bit and spread the fights, they would actually have a very good chance of coming back into this game.
Yeah, instead, right now, it looks like we have another squabble going on over another point as we have got this ranger. Is that a ranger? I have no idea what this is, so I'm just bad. I'm just going to shut up. Sean, go ahead and explain what I'm seeing on the screen right now.
Absolutely. We do have the fight over the meditation buff at the top of the map. Blue team did win. They were able to get everyone, and now they do have the 2x capture points. With 2 points, they're capturing points at around 4 a second, really extending their lead. Red team didn't need that to get back in. But if red team is able to get some decaps off right there, and they can get the tranquility buff that's going to be spawning in about 2 minutes, they do have a chance to get back into this game.
An excellent point. You know what I realized? I really do suck at this game. So, meanwhile, over here, looks like we've got a huge fight breaking out right now. Heal going down on to Nikki, as we've got what appears to be just both teams absolutely duking it out right now. Ranger going down on the part of the red team, as well as the thief. Yoda going down as well. Grizzrage about to fall, and there we go. Everybody on the red team going down. We can see the stomps going off as we have Mirox, Hyroxy going down immediately. Yoda about to go down, and then Nikki bleeding out, but it looks like she will be able to get back up. Mirox getting the rally off as well, but Yoda will go ahead and fall, and it looks like Nikki trying to get in here and do some damage on to this enemy. I believe that's a Mesmer. There's so much action going on in this game right now. I realize why this is so difficult to cast.
Absolutely. Red team was actually winning that fight, and they were doing fantastic. The problem they were having is that they could not get stomps off. Blue team was doing a fantastic job with the stability and the stealth reses, and ultimately the numbers won them that fight.
And it looks like we actually have Black being caught out right now. She will go ahead and be taken down. It looks like they're just going to go for the stomp and manage to take him out. Unfortunately, a member of TDTV falling there right now. Meanwhile, it looks like the temple is still under the red team's control. Blue team not successful in taking that. And it looks like both the altar and gate still belong to the blue team in a dominating lead for this match.
And coming up in 30 seconds, we'll have both the Tranquility and the stillness, Tranquility and Meditation buff coming up, which will give Tranquility, it'll give everyone the capture points. If Red Team could pop both of those and then continue to hold the points, they could actually make a comeback right here. This game could come back. That is one of the great things about this map.
That is an excellent point. It looks like we've got the Necromancers coming in here, trying to do as much damage as possible. It looks like he may end up following, as no fucking name is going to end up going down here. It looks like he will get the rally off, but Yoda, Nikki, and Mirox are both going down. Yoda managing to get that back up, but Mirox getting down very, very low as no fucking name once again goes down, and the stomp looks like it'll go off on him. Yes, and he will get defeated. Meanwhile, Roxy looks to have gone back up, but he's getting down very low. Those leads taking away, and he'll actually get taken down. Meanwhile, it looks like Kenigmatic over here is going to go ahead and fall as well, and the blue team will manage to clean up this fight with a quick and easy win.
They were able to take it out. No one even went for that second set of buffs right there. They all just kind of sat near Temple and played that team deathmatch, ultimately losing them that game.
All right, and as the fights wrap up, we will be getting into this next match. I think this is probably going to end up being our last match of the night. We'll go ahead and give us a nice point to end on. It looks like we're going to be in the Forest of Niflheim. I probably didn't say that right.
Niflheim, close enough. We almost got it. This is one of the great maps with the neutral buffs, awarding points as well as stat bonuses. So we do have the opportunity to see some really cool clutch plays here.
Ooh, that should be fun. Well, it looks like we are into the game, and we are going to go ahead and see the split off of both teams right now. Red team looking to start moving out of their base, and it looks like they are immediately going to go for the mine right now, or at least head up north towards those capture points. And blue team going immediately for their own. It looks like there's a ranger on the part of the blue team who's looking to do something maybe a little cheeky.
Yeah, it looks like he was going for a cross. I think he was expecting more people from blue team to start their buff, and he'd come in and try and steal it. But unfortunately, everyone from blue went straight for that point, started the buff. They were going to start the buff later, and they're going to be able to kill him. Pretty much just take him out in the beginning.
Yeah, Kenigmatic, unfortunately, totally getting caught out here. He is immediately going to get taken down, and the stomp will go off to go ahead and finish him off. Meanwhile, it looks like Grizz is in a little spot of his own here right now, and he is going to get down fairly low. But he's doing an excellent job dueling right now, and he's actually going to go ahead and maybe even take down. Yes, he will go ahead and take him down, and the stomp is going off, and there we go. That will be the end of it. Grizz getting out of there with barely any health left.
He actually got that teleport off, saved him a little bit of health, but there we go right there. One thing to note is that typically, if Grizz had actually stayed on the point and let him run away, he would have been able to capture that point, secured it for his team, and given his team a point advantage. But by chasing him, he did set them a little bit behind.
Yeah, unfortunate for him is there's now a complete brawl over this point right now, and it looks like Grizz getting down very low here. Well, the rest of the teams come up, and he will actually fall now. He's going to get down very low, doing his best to try and survive, but he will most likely get taken out here. Meanwhile, it looks like Insanity up here trying to do his best to take down Grizz, as well as Nikki is also going to fall, and Grizz simply going to bleed out at this point, but the stomp will go off, and he will get taken down. Nikki as well falling, as both of them have ended up going down, and no fucking name in here doing his best to defend. Don't believe it will be enough at this point, as he's going to go ahead and try and get an advantage on higher ground, but he should also get taken out here in this 3v1 situation, forced to now run away.
Absolutely. Blue team really won that fight with superior condition damage and boon control. They had stability through most of that fight, and they were really able just to stay up, get the stomps, and do the damage, resulting in a 2 capture point lead for them. And their points are really going in their favor.
All right, and it looks like red team's managed to actually pick up a point of their own now, as no fucking name continues to do his best to go ahead and contest this point over here. And it looks like he's getting into a duel now with Insanity, which is not quite going in King's favor right now. He's going to get quite low, and no fucking name forced to try and do a little bit of fancy footwork here to back out, but Insanity, unfortunately, he's just got the health over them. It's a 3v1 now, and no fucking name is going to go ahead and fall here.
Yeah, blue team's really doing great with this mid, but red team actually making up for a small mistake that they had last time. They knew that they couldn't win that mid fight, so they decided to split up. They were able to get both side points for quite a while, and actually caught up in points a little bit. They are still far behind, but if they continue to do that throughout this game, that would be a great way for them to catch up and maybe win this game.
And it does look like the points nowhere near the same dominating lead we've seen the last couple of games right now. But still, this point just so highly contested. Insanity just kind of sitting here doing his best to defend. Do you think the blue team is making a good move by kind of just sitting on this point right now?
I don't think it's the best move they can make. They have far too many people here. They are in the lead, but if they were able to help secure mine as well instead of leaving just one person there, it would make them a little more map secure, so when these buffs are coming up, they would have better control of them.
Speaking of, it actually looks like Grizz is now contesting one of these particular points right now. He's actually gotten quite a bit of health back. Lovely, lovely Guardian heals right there as he continues to go ahead and face off against this Ranger right now. And it looks to actually be going quite in his favor. A couple of nice jukes, and it looks like he will go ahead and take them down, attempting to go for the stomp. And no, he will not be able to blink out of that. And that will be a nice captured point on the part of Grizzrage.
And they are actually, red team was pushing towards Fawnir. Yeah, they're kind of backing off as someone came. Not a problem. But again, that's kind of what I was saying. Blue team had too many resources focused mid, and instead of helping to hold mine, they lost it. They now lost keep. And red team is kind of making the plays they need to get back into the game.
I feel like I should make the statement here before anybody starts laughing at me on YouTube or in chat when these videos eventually goes up. I'm a League of Legends caster. I have no idea what I'm doing in Guild Wars 2. This is probably only about the fourth time I've seen PvP in my life.
You're actually doing a fantastic job, so job. A little more knowledge, and it's going to be great.
Yeah, we'll have to see what happens there, but it looks like we've got another point being contested now. Grizzrage doing his best to defend at this point, but now kind of just spinning in circles, because apparently that's what Grizzrage is like to do. And it looks like we've also got a Guardian on the part of the blue team, getting a little bit of that height advantage now, and just trying to poke at a range until she can come in with some reinforcements and go ahead and kind of contest this point.
And while that was going on, blue team was actually able to steal Svanir from red team. They came in, they took down two members, and they got that 25 points from the buff as well as the tap bonus. Really furthering their lead, and now they're doing just fantastic with the side point. The burst damage coming out of blue is really doing great in these smaller skirmishes.
An excellent point. So it looks like we have got this Guardian over here just looking for a chance to come in. Insanity has come in, so she now has a backup she needs, and they're going to go in for the duel here, and it looks like she is going to go ahead and get knocked back, get right back into that fight. Grizzrage going to be knocked down, and it looks like he's going to manage to avoid that stomp for now, but it's only a matter of time before he eventually goes down, and this will likely be the end of our warrior friend here. He is, yes, there we go. He's finally going to fall. I know Grizz is a Guardian, but as far as I'm concerned, he's a warrior because, you know, he's like big, beefy man. Believe it or not,
and he's
actually
got that sword, you know. And that's something
exactly.
To see
exactly.
She looks like a warrior.
Yeah. I'll learn the differences.
That knockback was a little bit of a strategy right there. Instead of taking a while to maybe get that stomp, they decided to banish him off the point, start doing damage to them, and actually start capping that point without worrying about his the down body contesting the point.
You know, one of the biggest problems that I can see for the red team right now is they kind of seem to be throwing themselves into these 2v1 situations. Like you can see with Yoda right now, he kind of just threw himself into this Guardian and Warrior combo and just kind of ended up dying for it. The same goes for Grizz. They've been throwing themselves into really unfavorable fights that have allowed them to keep these points pretty dominantly.
And most of red team, blue team, they have really good team fighting synergies with the classes that they're playing and the builds that they're playing. Red team does have good 1v1s, but when they go into a strong 1v2, they're going to lose. They're going to lose every time, and those kills are just racking it up and helping blue secure their advantage and maybe secure the victory. It is getting rather close here.
Yeah, it actually looks like No Fucking Name right now is going to get taken down. He's pretty much just been left to get DPS down, and that will be the end of him. No chance for a stomp there. Nobody wanting to get too close at that point, as the only person who could was a Mesmer, who was fairly low. And now it looks like Grizz is actually back to trying to contest some points. He is going to go ahead and get the stomp off right now, manage to take out that Guardian, and then go back to this unfortunate duel that is going to leave him very low, if not dead. So he goes ahead and chases down onto that Necromancer before returning to the point to try and defend.
And we actually have most of red team really trying to keep this henge point. And while that's fantastic, if they're not able to neutralize the other 2 points, it is going to result in an inevitable defeat.
It looks like Grizz is actually going to get really low right now, and he is going to fall. Avarice going on a rampage right now, and then No Fucking Name finally back up. But it looks like Nikki also fell, and now Avarice getting low as well. At Necromancer may end up falling here, and yes, he is going to go down. The question is, will they be able to DPS him down? Unfortunately, the only one there to do so was Kenigmatic, but he got taken down by the enemy. Again, these 2v1 situations just not going well at all, and we are 1 point away, and yes, that will be the end of the match. Blue team is going to go ahead and take that home.
Almost twice the score right there. Blue team's superior presence in fights, especially in those 2v1 fights that we saw a lot of. It really led to them keeping and holding those points throughout the game, and ultimately secured their victory.
All excellent points to note, and ladies and gentlemen, I actually think that'll be it. So yeah, this has been Lunette the Herald, your Scrubtastic caster today, casting here with Sean, probably one of the best Guild Wars 2 casters in the community at this point. Hi, Sean.
How's it going, Lunette? You actually did a fantastic job today. For someone, Lunette has rarely plays League of Legends, but Guild Wars 2. She plays a lot of League of Legends.
Yeah.
Maybe, what are you, like, rank 4, rank 3?
Yeah, something like that.
Barely played, never casted Guild Wars before. I think she did a fantastic job.
Yeah, and if only we can get the Guild Wars 2 knowledge up to the point where my League knowledge is, and I'll pretty much be good to go. But until that point, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Game Analysis Night for both League of Legends as well as Guild Wars 2. Some nice casting training going on today. We will see you guys tomorrow with some casual games night. Be sure to tune in. Check us out on Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, all under the name, you guessed it, Tower Dive TV. And we will see you guys later.